Hey everybody, we're getting ready. We're going to start right now. Again, for those of you who are remote, please check the audio section of the control panel. There you'll find your telephone number, if you're doing it by telephone, your access code, and your PIN. That allows me to unmute you at the time for your presentation. If you have any questions at all during the webinar, please write them in the question section. I'll be monitoring. So turning it over to Wayne.
Thank you, Andy, and good morning, everybody, and welcome March. I guess March is coming in like a lamb. I don't know if it'll go out like a lion or not. Hopefully not, but here we are. Wanted to kick it off by saying a call today is a little bit of a different format in the sense that obviously we're going to focus more on certain key issues. Part of our new communication plan with counties is to look at different methods of communication and use our calls for perhaps more in-depth conversation about certain topics. I think the other thing about our calls in hearing feedback from directors is that we've got a lot of information, and I will say up front, we don't have any control over the amount of information or all of the things happening in our different programs. There's a lot happening, and you know that. Our key here is to try to conceptualize how to best communicate in the best fashion with directors and leadership of the most important information. I think to some extent maybe what we try to do is to give you as much as fast as we can in 2 hours and a half, and after a while if you're like me, your hand's falling off from taking notes and that sort of thing. So we'll slow it down a little bit. And the other thing I'd like to see happen is a little bit more with questions. We've got some questions today we've developed that will help lead our conversation. Again, a big part of the conversation today is going to be about budget estimates and budgeting for next year, block grants, things you need to know. A lot of this is going to be, estimate, speculative. We don't know until we get a budget from the General Assembly all the final answers to this. Another thing I want to mention is a part of our communication plan is the social services monthly updates, and we got our first one out for February at the end of the month last week. This will be our plan going forward on a monthly basis. Our March edition, we anticipate trying to get out the last week, and hopefully before the last day of the last week of the month of March, prior to our next conference call, the first Tuesday in April. So some of the things that we're looking at are just updates. We've got stuff again here on child support, upcoming events. Dear County Director and dear County Director letters and admin letters, we hopefully, once we get on a month-by-month basis, we may be able to put those in there and with a link to them. There's a lot of them, so we're still looking at that, but we think it's important to have a summary of the director letters and admin letters that have gone out by program, just so you don't miss anything. Recordings of webinars is listed, and then we will probably have updates on a regular basis from our operational support team, from our local business liaisons, from our fiscal monitors, and from some other folks. So be looking out for that. Feedback is welcomed in terms of what you want to see. Appreciate everybody's work on this. Ryan Hill from our communications office has helped us with the formatting. Kathy, some of these folks sort of took the lead from the fiscal perspective, and this will be ongoing. So give us feedback. That would be helpful. Moving along, let's talk about some budget estimates. And first up is child support.
I think they're on the phone.
Judy's on the phone. Yeah. And really what I'm looking at is the overview of the budget estimates for 2016-17. And as you note there, it states that our child support office will withhold 15% of the federal earned incentives received beginning with July 1, 2016. We have a work group that is in place in order to work on coming up with recommendations. This went through a committee, it went through a study committee, went through the General Assembly. engagement from our county DSS, our private providers, child support services, and our state child support office. Again, working in collaboration with our Department of Information Technology around enhancements that will pay off in dividends as far as collections of child support and achieving our outcomes going forward. This is what we want to make sure that we do with the program. Do we know if Judy McCarn is on the, I don't think Judy's with us. If there are any questions about child support or about this process, please let us know. I think given the fact that, you know, the 15% would be withheld, I think you'd be looking in your estimates at your anticipated revenue, probably minus about 15% from what you've been seeing. We did pass the data reliability, the audit we had in child support, so there won't be any loss of any federal revenue this year, this coming year as far as incentives. So this should be the only impact in terms of your revenue. Second thing I want to talk about is NC Corals, our county reimbursement ledger suite. And again, you do have in your budget estimates for 16-17 the amount of the EFT that would be required from your county based on the formula that we had discussed earlier. This will be a factor. We did the EFT for 15-16. We'll have it in there for 16-17. We'll have it in there ongoing. But the uplift part of it, the big cost is going to be spread over 15-16, 16-17, and then again next year, year after next, 17-18. After that, it's just pretty much maintenance and update and the support person to answer questions on the business side. Any questions? Okay.
Questions?
All right. I'm going to ask Jennifer Johnson to sort of move over into the chair next to me here. We're going to talk about child care subsidy in terms of budget estimates. And I think if you want to start, I've got some questions and we can go back and forth.
Okay. I'll do a brief update. So we are working on webinars for providers in preparation for NC FAST. The Self-Employment Gainful Employment Admin Letter that was issued on February 15th is actually effective today, March 1st. And as a reminder, NC FAST is conducting virtual workshops with counties on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and the last one is this Thursday. So if you have not participated, please try to do so. So on to subsidized child care. Expenditure reports. Statewide, we're at 95% combined spending as of February expenditures for January services. It does reflect the new infant toddler market rates that were effective on January 1st. Our total year-to-date expenditures is $209,957,536, which is leaving us right around $128 million left with a spending coefficient of 94%. Emails went out on Friday to counties where we are planning to take reversion amounts. And so we have asked that you contact your LBL by Friday if that reversion amount is not going to work for your county so that we can try to do reversion reallocations on Monday. If you were not contacted for a reversion amount, you may begin working your waiting list, but do so judiciously as you don't want to go into the start of next year overspending. So I think that is where I will stop my brief report, and now we'll get to questions.
There's one question. What did you say is effective today?
The Self-Employment Gainful Employment Admin Letter that was issued on February 15th.
Yeah. Okay. I think there probably are a lot of questions about child care subsidy, and so I sat down and actually talked to Jennifer earlier about some of the questions that I might ask or that you might ask or it might be relevant to the issue. I think one of the questions would be, as we go into next year in 16-17, we understand that there is a plan schedule for counties to begin, and I think we addressed this in the overview to the budget estimates. So if you're a pilot county, I believe it's August, and then if you're in the West, it's September.
Yes.
If you're in the East, it's October.
Yes.
So one of the questions we've had from county directors is, so as far as the pass-through money where your county is paying out and being reimbursed, how many months should your county budget for pass-through money before all the payments for child care subsidy would be direct paid through FIS by the state? And I think in our estimates, what we said, that if all things go as planned, then we have those months that you would plan for based on being a pilot, being in the West, or being in the East. I think there's some other things you probably need to consider. Certainly one of those is, what is your projected spending by month? Because a lot of counties spend more in the summer when they have the after-school age kids in full-time care. And where are you coming into the June month, reimbursed in July next year, in terms of your spending this year as you transition? As Jennifer said, some counties may be clearing waiting lists, you may be up, you know, more than 1/12 in each of those months. The other factor I think to consider, I guess, would be, are we absolutely certain that that those months of beginning with the state making those payments are as we planned? I would think, Jennifer, that if there are issues or something's not working right, they're not locked in stone.
Correct.
So, another consideration.
Yeah.
I think this is a conversation with your finance director for your county. Might you want to be conservative or play it safe and say, you know, we'll budget 6 months worth? At the end of the day, I think you should better err on the side of assuring that you got enough money in the revenue side for the expenditure side, so you don't have to go back for the budget amendment because it took longer than 3 months or 4 months or whatever. Theoretically, a county could budget the whole thing for the year, and then once it stops, then you stop passing through. Again, I think that's a question. A couple other questions. One, and I'm going to ask Jennifer these questions. With the change to the state making the payments directly to providers, and with the attendance sheet being handled correctly between the provider and state office, what would be the impact on administrative support for child care subsidy programs?
Well, initially, there will be lots of questions, and the providers will need that administrative support. But as they become more savvy in using the NCFAS system, it's a time for your admin support to be transferred or to be cross-trained in learning other skills to support other programs that may currently be in NCFAS or be moving to NCFAS, or for whatever other needs you may see fit.
Yeah.
So at this time, we're not saying that there would be any reduction in staff at your local offices, but it might be a time to look at what your business needs are.
Right. I think that from a perspective from back in my day in planning ahead for SEEK, when the payments would be made by the state through that, I think we calculated our administrative support person in subsidized child care. It was one full-time FTE, one FTE, we thought would end up with about half-time. So maybe about 50% of the work may come off. The other part, of course, when the payments are made directly by the state, would also impact downstream at the county level through your internal office in terms of preparing vouchers and payment requests and check writing by your county finance department, things like that. I think the point Jennifer makes is a good one. Child care providers are going to have a lot of questions when we get into the direct payment to them and the new process. And I believe there's going to be a call center system set up.
Yes.
But as we know, a lot of these folks know your people. They know they're a worker. They know their administrative support. The providers know that administrative support person in the county that handles their attendance sheets and those sorts of things. So they're just as likely probably to pick up the phone and call you. So I think your point is well taken. If I were sitting in a county today, I would budget my administrative support staff and child care subsidy for the year, and then hope that before the end of the year we might be able to transition them into other kinds of duties. And I have no doubt that in county DSSs, you have plenty of needs that those folks could transition to. Then the second question, I think, would be, what would be the impact with the change on the income maintenance caseworker, the caseworker that has eligibility for child care subsidy?
Again, they will have to transition all of the cases into NCFAS, and then it becomes that online portal, but there will still be counties where parents are going to want to do the paper. And so there will still be that need for the child care worker, for sure, in this first year as we're still transitioning and moving families to this new system. And then, again, there's that cross-training that can take place if they're eligible for the merit-based activities and the other NCFAS programs.
And I think we've got some questions. And I think the other thing would be that the eligibility process would continue. And I think a follow-up question, and we're going to take some questions on the call here, but I think a follow-up question we'd come back to would be a couple things. The impact of the federal requirement that we only do recertifications annually versus every 6 months. We've got a couple on the call.
A couple of questions came in online. There are several providers who indicate they do not have internet or computers at their locations, seemingly may not be able to afford it. Will there be any support provided by the state to provide providers with such a complication?
We are looking to our child care resource and referral network, as well as our Smart Start partners, to actually maybe have a kiosk set up for the providers so that they can load their attendance sheets virtually that way. And there's also a proposed rule possibly moving forward through the Child Care Commission that will require all providers to have email addresses, which does not mean they have to have a computer in their home, but it will require all providers to become a little more computer savvy.
Okay, second question. So the child care subsidy position should transition to an IMC support position?
I think that's a good point. Your administrative support staff in child care subsidy, once we get through the transition, because honestly, I would not be surprised to see as we go through this transition in counties to NCFAS that your calls coming into your administrative support person may actually go up instead of go down. And that could be also true for your eligibility staff. And I think over a period of time, that will flatten out, and hopefully those providers will get comfortable with the system, calls will go down, and based on our estimates, I think from what we kind of know, you should have time of administrative support staff and child care subsidy that could be utilized in other areas. So I think looking at how it would support your other programs, I think would be a perfect way to go about doing business.
Can Jennifer tell us who the reversion requests went to? Did these go to the directors?
Yes, emails for the reversion requests went to the directors on Fridays, on this past Friday, as well as all the local business liaisons. Your LBLs were copied. So you can feel free to email myself or Janice Fain if you did not receive an email, or your local business liaison if they can tell you all the ones that did receive them. There were approximately 15 counties.
Another question, did I understand you correctly that once all cases are entered into NCFAS, that after the first year, the IMC worker will not be needed?
No. No, I think we're talking about the administrative support person. Will still be needed. I think some information I've seen may be about 50%, but that's plus or minus depending. No, I think the eligibility worker, and that kind of brings us back to the question I was just asking Jennifer previously, let's go to that, is the impact on the eligibility worker, the caseworker, and I know some counties it's an income maintenance caseworker, some it's a social worker, but anyway, the person does eligibility for child care subsidy. What will be the impact? And I think, to me, I think the eligibility process is still there. The one change that Jennifer, I think, could be an impact is the fact that we're now required for recertifications to be done annually.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Versus every 6 months, and some counties have done quarterly.
Yes.
I would think that could have some impact.
We expect it to have impact as far as there will be less turnover in child care, so it will create longer waiting lists as a possibility, but it is a federal requirement that children and families remain eligible for a minimum of 12 months. and then the proposed new rule before the Social Services Commission is then there would be a 90-day step-down period at the end of that 12-month eligibility.
Now, so we actually showed more administrative money this year in child care than last. Was this a mistake? We had $160,000 on the state estimates, where before we got $80,000.
I think the estimates for administrative are based upon the percentage of the estimates of child care subsidy money. So therefore, I think, and I'm looking at Kathy here, we would have calculated the percentage of admin for child care subsidy based on your allocation of child care subsidy dollars.
You also might want to go back and relook at those estimates, because I think there was an error when they were first issued. I think the error was even before we sent out a notice. So I would go back and look at that again.
Mm-hmm. But I think is it $80,000, I'm trying to remember.
I think it was erroneously doubled the first time when they were
paid. Yeah, whatever the percent is, percent of admin, percent of your subsidy dollars, or $80,000, whichever is greater. Right. That doesn't change. Don't see anything at this point that's going to change that in this short session.
Correct.
Okay. You have more questions?
I have a lot more questions.
Come on. I thought I was going to have to ask you questions, and I was prepared to do that. But
what's
let's go.
The status of child support requirement for child care subsidy? Will this start when NCFAS P3 begins?
No.
David is also on
okay.
the line if you want me to.
Well, I think let me say, I think it's, first of all, the plan report has been submitted to the General Assembly. Don't have it in front of me. However, I think there is included there a recommendation for a pilot of that process that would be offline from NCFAS. It will not begin with P3. It will be a little further downstream, but after doing a pilot and looking at how it works and learning from that process, then it would fall back on the preparation time for NCFAS to do it in the system for everybody. There is a fiscal note attached to the report. I'm thinking about $1.75 million, could be a little bit off on that, that would have to be appropriated to prepare NCFAS for that process. If David's on the call, anything else from the NCFAS end in terms of implementation?
Hold on one second. He's unmuted. David?
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Go ahead.
I actually don't have anything to add to what Wayne and Jennifer have covered so far in regards to either the child support enforcement topic or anything previous covered with the budget and that sort of, you know, planning, those bullet points that Wayne covered earlier. So far, I don't have any additional information that I can add from an NCFAS perspective.
There are a couple other NCFAS questions while we have David on the line we might want to get to. Is the classification in NCFAS for staff completing daycare an IMCW?
So I guess from an NCFAS perspective, we have what we call security roles, which is essentially a profile of what the user can do in the system. It has been the practice and sort of the policy from the state and county that it's the discretion of the county to provide the security role to the individual at the county level based upon their job description and their duties. So at NCFAS, we have a couple of different security roles that can be selected based upon how the local office wants that to be handled. From a official classification perspective, that's something I can't necessarily comment on. I'd have to look probably to Wayne and Jennifer on that one.
Okay.
Unknown yet.
I mean, I think we're in process. I think the key thing here would be at some point in time looking at the pilot to test the process. That's probably the next thing on the to-do list after we come down.
Hey, another NCFAS question with child care is, with the inclusion of child care into NCFAS, wage information will be known to the agency when an FNS recertification is completed. Will counties be required to act on this known information and make changes in the child care record?
I'll go ahead first, David, and then you can follow up. This is Jennifer, and the child remains eligible for those 12 months. So even if you know that their income has changed, they are still eligible for those 12 months. So you wouldn't act until their 12-month eligibility period was exhausted.
Several other questions. Will the allocation after reversion become our base funding for the next fiscal year?
One of the things that we, and I'll take this from Jennifer,
okay,
because it was involved in the process of talking about this. One of the things involved in the reversion process from counties is we did look at counties that were underspending, but we made it a point that we're only recommending reversions from counties for child care subsidy that would leave the county with 96% of your allocation for this year. Why? Because you need to, if you can spend it. Now, don't go, if you can't spend it, you know, don't go crazy. But we wanted to give counties the opportunity to spend the 95% with a 1% cushion so as to revert back going into next year. Revert's not the right word. That going into next year, your allocation would be the same as your initial allocation for 2015-16. Counties that spend, this is going to be in place next year unless something changes in the General Assembly. Counties that spent less than 95% of their allocation this year will receive that amount of money for subsidy next year.
Correct.
If you spend 95% or more of your allocation for this year, then next year you'll receive 100% of your initial allocation for this year. So we wanted to do reversions, but we did not want to take any more money from counties than would still give them a 1% cushion of money left above the 95%, so you wouldn't have to spend it down to the penny, just give you a little bit of leeway.
Okay, next question. Will the recertification process change, as we know that lots of changes occur within 12 months?
I guess there's been feedback to the federal rule.
There has been feedback to the rules regarding that 12-month eligibility, but that 12-month eligibility is in federal law. So as far as what will be required during the recertification process, we are still waiting on guidance from the federal government.
Will we be able to go after fraud cases now once the payments are made directly by the state?
Oh, so payments are made by the state, so basically my understanding, Jennifer, would be, as it stands right now, you know, if you find fraud and there's a payback, then that is reduced from your allocation. Well, not reduced from your allocation. You're covering it with county dollars until you recoup the money from the provider or from the client. So when those payments are being made by the state and not from the county, then that wouldn't involve county dollars. It would still come out of the state allocation. So I think the disincentive when this starts, this is something that we've talked about for years, and the disincentive has been with child care subsidy that finding fraud, identifying fraud, and then that payback process, you have to have county dollars to cover it until you get the recoupment from the client or the provider. That goes away, and so that disincentive is removed.
Two more. Going back to an earlier statement and a question, we also noticed a basic doubling of our admin money, and we have not seen any update or correction. Will that be coming?
Doubling of child care admin?
That's what it says.
We're going to need to follow up on that. It sounds like there is an issue with child care admin. So look for us to send out something to clarify that. Kathy, Alicia will do that.
And the last one I have, with whom should we discuss this dramatic cut in our service support?
Dramatic cut in services support. I'm not sure what that means. We haven't had a cut in service support from the perspective of the admin dollars from the state.
Or from the personnel.
After everything's done, when we said they maybe reduced the admin.
Or are they talking about policy support from OSD?
We need more information on that particular question.
There is a follow-up. I asked an early question about administrative dollars and pulled the budget estimate again, and it has been corrected. It's no longer doubled.
Okay, so the updated one is there. We'll just note that. Good. Any other questions there?
Just the other one, it says the child care subsidy position draws a lot of overhead. It's just a statement.
This is true. Okay. Well, I appreciate all the questions that came in. I was prepared to ask Jennifer four or five more questions, and in the interest of time, I think we're going to be looking to move on. Okay. Jennifer, thank you.
Thank you.
The next thing I wanted to mention is, and I'll ask Carolyn to come over, is in regard to the admin letter, factors. It was actually a Dear County Manager, Dear Director letter regarding factors impacting economic services programs in North Carolina. And everybody, I think, has seen this. Again, this is a document that we wanted to send out to directors and county managers, and I think, and it was forwarded, I believe, to county finance directors as well as assistant county managers for human services and human service directors through their county commissioners association. What we try to do is these are all of the factors that impact your workload. There was caseload. Caseload growth was mainly 08 to 13 due to the recession. But although Medicaid has still slightly gone up since then, it's leveled off, I believe, Carol, a little bit now. FNS went up between 8 and 13 by about 75% of the state and sort of leveled off since that time. But the factors that are listed here impact the workload. They impact staffing. They impact what you need to get the work done in the county. And I'm not going to go over this other than to say that you might, in your own county, be looking at your own data on this. And in terms of some of your numbers, in terms of impact, and you may have impacts beyond this. So this is a tool, but it's also an educational tool we wanted to use to, again, communicate, because we've gotten feedback from county managers at a meeting, particularly one was once we get through, once things calm down with NC Fast, will we get back to normal? Mm-hmm. And so that prompted our discussion about the new normal. Mm-hmm. And I thank Urban County, some of those folks, and you know, for some of this discussion that kind of prompted come out of that. And so the new normal is discussed in this letter. You also have some information about consequences. We tried to be very candid about that in terms of what we could face. And then very end of it, there's an attachment. We do reference the threat of a lawsuit. We had one. It was 1974. It was Clara Alexander did not get her AFTC benefits on time in Mecklenburg County, as I recall. Not picking on Mecklenburg. It just happened to be where they found an individual for a class action suit. Dr. Hill was the secretary of probably the Department of Human Resources at the time. And so began the long and arduous and multi-million dollar cost saga of Alexander Hill, Flaherty, Brett, Bruton, Hooker Odom, et al. And we're still living with it. So if you want to see the Alexander Bruton summation, that's also included. Are there any questions about this letter?
Not from the online.
Okay. The next, and again, these were included in the budget overview because we just wanted to highlight them and bring everybody's attention to them. The next one is merit-based requirements for eligibility work. To summarize, employees that do eligibility, which means they interview clients and do certification in NC Fast, they do eligibility, or if they're doing paper, they're still doing eligibility, are required to be merit-based employees. and there are six factors that constitute merit requirements. And what we're saying here basically, and have concluded that in order to meet requirements for USDA and for CMS, and CMS, I believe, Carolyn, also states that they must be employees of the state Medicaid agency. In this case, that would be the county.
Which includes the counties, right.
So therefore, we conclude that, and same for USDA, you've got to be merit-based employees, which means you have to work for the county department of social services. You have to be employees of the county department of social services. You cannot be contracted by the county. You cannot be an individual, whether they're qualified or not, in terms of eligibility experience, employed by a third party. You cannot have a contract for workers to do eligibility. They must be DSS county employees. Then we get into, what about merit requirements for county employees? And some of the conversations that I've had with folks, you know, my take would be that if many counties have set up temporary positions or set up positions for temporary staff or bring in staff. Some counties may have positions where your temporary staff work when you need them and then don't work when you don't need them or when they don't want to. I've had a lot of retirees in the past who worked maybe in the wintertime or the fall or the spring, but in the summer they didn't want to work. That sort of corresponds to the workload seasonal impact of A-bonds, and, I mean, I'm sorry, not A-bonds, TurboTax season, as well as the Affordable Care Act coming down applications from the marketplace. So I think I've had situations where I've had part-time employees that work for years on a regular basis, 15 hours a week, or come intermittently. The main thing there, again, I would think that counties when you have temporary employees doing seasonal work or helping with the workload, that you're looking at mostly people that have been eligibility workers. They retired from your county. They may have gone out on maternity leave and have a young child, but they only want to work part-time. But you're typically not bringing people in off the street. So the key things here, the merit principles apply, and it is a responsibility as we determine that the county must determine if they meet merit requirements. And I think this is where working with your county HR. If there's any questions, I've gotten some comments, some questions from HR directors, from county directors about this, and welcome those questions. I think one of the questions we had was if you have a Medicaid worker stationed at a hospital, and some situations the hospital puts up the non-federal share, I guess, Carolyn, but can the hospital employ the person and put up the non-federal share? And the answer is
no.
No. Because right. they're working for another entity, they're not working for the DSS, right. They're not a merit-based employee.
And that is really important about the hospital workers, even the outstation staff you have there, they must be employed and their work directed by and supervised by the county. We've had some issues with that over the years where the hospital is trying to, direct the work of those folks, but it really has to be the county.
Are there any questions?
No questions.
Okay. Now, one thing I wanted to note that we said in this letter, it says, as counties prepare for staffing needs from their 2016-17 budget, we want to ensure that federal merit requirements for individuals performing eligibility determinations in both Medicaid and food nutrition mm-hmm. services are understood. Right. So, I will say that as far as USDA is concerned, I'm looking at David Locklear down here. We had an M&E finding. I've been working with two surveys with counties. The final one was to determine that there are absolutely no non-merit-based employees, contracted or contracted through an agency, that are working in food nutrition doing eligibility work in counties. And our conclusion is that the last survey is there's none. And there needs to be none, and it needs to stay none. We do understand in the Medicaid world that there may be counties that have depended upon contracted employees in that regard in the past. But as far as what we're saying is, as you prepare for your budget for 2016-17, and this is part of the reason for the letter being in with budget estimates, is you need to plan in 16-17 that you have no individuals doing eligibility, certainly none in food stamps now, because we've already closed that door with USDA, but also none in Medicaid as you begin the fiscal 16-17 budget year that do not meet merit requirements for eligibility.
And the eligibility functions are pretty broad. One of the things that CMS has told us down to a kind of a detail is that even evaluating an application and determining what information to request is an eligibility function. That cannot be done by someone who is a non-merit-based employee. So anything that relates to eligibility, evaluating information, doing the interview, keying into NCFAS, our eligibility system for most things would be an eligibility function.
Okay. And Carolyn, I think other updates while we're talking here regarding Medicaid?
You should have gotten a Deer County Director letter posted through the Directors Association about requesting auto extensions in order to continue with those for this month. Counties who feel like they will need an auto extension need to send a plan to me, and the letter outlines what needs to be in the plan, why it's being requested, what your time frame for catching up is, what steps you are taking and have taken that are long-term, not just short-term necessarily, that will get you caught up in the time frame that you're requesting on the letter. And so I need to have those by March 5th, if possible. I know that's a Saturday, thought about that, so we'll say Monday the 7th. But that needs to come to me, and I will be working with Dave Richard, who's our Assistant Secretary for DMA, to look at those plans and contact the county about approving an extension. If any extensions are needed past March, then we would just need a monthly progress report and making sure that we're staying on track with the plan that was implemented. In addition, there was a Deer County Director letter that was posted about trust and annuity reviews. DMA has contacted with HMS, who also does a lot of our third-party work, and they have an employee who is reviewing the special needs, pooled trust, all those kinds of legal documents that have a bearing on Medicaid eligibility, estate recovery, transfer of assets. And many times the lawyers have been couching those documents in very vague and ambiguous terms, and it's been very difficult. So we have a person who is specializing in reviewing those for counties. That information on his contact, Richard Gambrill, is in the letter. And he will be reviewing those and letting the county staff know what impact it has on Medicaid eligibility or state recovery. I want to do one other update that I just got. We are testing in NCFAS the implementation of the pre-populated renewal form. That is a requirement under healthcare reform. And we haven't been able to implement that yet. We have been using the 5199 sort of as a transitional renewal form, but that pre-populated form is being tested and may be implemented about the middle of this month, so there will be a lot more information coming out about that.
Question did just come in about the merit-based system. Does county temps qualify as merit based worker? Temps do not receive benefits nor eligible for performance increase.
Right. And, you know, again, a lot of your temporary staff may be retirees or those folks who don't want to work on a full-time basis. My experience has been that that is usually the case. I think that's where you have to work with your HR department on that, because, you know, I think I would make the argument that, they are, you know, when you look at temporary workers, you're bringing in folks that have retired or know the program, you're looking for people that are eligible, that know how to do eligibility. You need to have a payment plan. You're not paying them minimum wage to come in and do eligibility. So a lot of counties may look at what is the payment plan, what's the steps for income maintenance caseworker two. In some situations, if they retire, take a month off and come back and work part-time, you may leave them at the salary they were making, but certainly salary needs to be commensurate with an economic services income maintenance caseworker too, and that you don't just try to drop it down to get somebody. And the understanding with the individual is that this is what they want to do, and that's been the case for most everybody that I know about. And then as far as the political factors, I mean, most counties having their personnel, anybody working for them, you can't go out and campaign and do these sorts of things as far as political activity. The fair treatment, I think, in terms of those requirements is the fifth requirement there. I think that's one. So basically, they meet qualifications, they're paid, they're supervised, and they're held accountable, and they're treated as with the respect that you give to a county employee and expectations around political activity.
But the bottom line, they still have to be considered by the county HR as a merit.
Yes. I mean, there's no way around that, and that is defined, and of course, that the county is responsible for attesting that the person meets the merit-based requirements. So.
Yeah.
And then just a general DMA question here. When DMA staff send out the DCDLs, can they include a link to the website where the letter can be found? Other divisions do this, and it's a real time saver.
Yes, and I did notice that the last message went out this week did not have the link, and so, yes, we will try to make sure that the link is in there. As you all know, the websites have been redone, and I actually have found where they are myself on the new website now, but, yes, we will try to include the link.
Okay.
One just came. Are clients already able to report changes to Medicaid cases or any program now via NCFAST, i.e. EPAS?
The change of circumstances has not been implemented as yet. I'm not sure where that is on the calendar. Maybe we can get an update from NCFAST, but as of yet, my understanding is they cannot.
Okay. That it? All right. Thank you, Carolyn. And one other quick note. Okay. On crisis intervention program, low-income energy assistance program, we do speak to that also in the overview of the budget estimates to basically note that the low-income energy program and the crisis intervention program will be going into NCFAST. All 100 counties targeted for October 1, 2016. At this point in time, counties should continue to budget both revenue and expenditures for CIP and LEAP, whereas with child care subsidy, the state, the FIS, will be making the direct payment to vendor. At this point in time, I think I'm right, David, okay, that the payments for energy programs, LEAP and SIP, will be made, continually be made by the county with reimbursement, so no change in that process going forward. Okay, all right. Moving on down, I want to talk a little bit about other budget issues, and one of the questions that I get sometimes is, why do the budget estimates continue to reflect a decrease in county funding for the Work First County Block Grant? And what are the reasons for that? And there are a couple. In 2014-15, our funding levels for TANF was $313.4 million, really $313.5 million. In 15-16, our funding level availability was $303.3 million. So that's essentially slightly over $10 million less availability in TANF funds. Projected in the biennial budget, which would be, I think, our basis for the estimates going out, was availability of TANF dollars for 16-17 at roughly $301 million, which is, again, slightly a little over $2 million less in those estimates based upon the biennium budget than was available in the current year. That all has an impact. The additional thing is then both in 15-16, added to the TANF block grant for NCFAST development was $1.3 million approximately. For 16-17 is a little over $1.8 million. And then for eligibility systems, operation and maintenance, about $2.7 million was in 15-16 this year. About $4.2 million is in the biennium budget for next year in 16-17. These are costs associated with county performance of eligibility that had to be paid for somewhere. Balancing all of that out, I think we may have had a slight decrease from about $3 million from 14-15 to 15-16 in the anticipated expenditure budget for cash assistance payments. With that, I think Angela Taylor or David Jobachini may be able to comment on the some of the costs included in those two items of NCFAST and operations and maintenance.
David Ron.
Hi, so this is Angela. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So some of the things that for the operation and maintenance for NCFAST is the ongoing support of the architecture that we have. That would be the hardware. And one of those things, as we've shared, is in the effort to continuously improve, is looking at additional tools that we have put in place to help monitor and track some of the stuff. And also we are refreshing some of the equipment that is now over 5 years, which is past its life expectancy. But as we always try in state government to reutilize things, our plan is to take some of that equipment and push it into our testing environment. As most of you are aware, we are working with community colleges, and we have a sandbox for them. And so those are where we're trying to make sure that we're utilizing things as much as possible. And so a lot of the expenditures that you see for the O&M is just the care and feeding of the system and making sure that we're continuously improving that. And also, as you're aware, that, you know, FNS is 100% now in O&M, and we're working on some of the Medicaid pieces. So the ongoing efforts to, you know, as we have defect resolutions, change requests that come from DMA and DSS, all of those things are included in our ongoing O&M.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Angie. One thing I also note that I want to make sure that everybody knows and hasn't forgotten. The biggest impact on TANF block grant funds, when we look at these numbers across, you know, 313, 314, 300, 4 years ago, I think it's 4 or 5 years ago, the Congress eliminated something called TANF supplemental funds, and it was for North Carolina. We were one of 15 southeastern southern states, mainly, that received something called TANF supplemental funding. In North Carolina, it was $36.1 million per year, and it went from 36.1 to nothing. So at that time, we had TANF funds that we just mentioned, around $300 million or lower. We had TANF supplemental funds of $36.1 million, and then we still do have TANF contingency. So the TANF supplemental funds were for 15 states based upon having low cash assistance payments amounts. So when they switched from AFDC to a block grant, and that was done in 1995-96, this bill was put in to try to balance the playing field, so to speak, because New York or California, where they were having payments for a family of three, was $600-$800 a month, and we were at $272, and other southern states predominantly were at low payment. And if they give us a block grant, then we really are held down in that regard. Well, Congress decided to do away with that. North Carolina has done, a really good job of trying to make up for that to some extent by being able to draw down TANF contingency funds over the years. And to some extent, that's fluctuated and it's gone up a little bit. But TANF contingency funds are variable. And the amount of fundings available to North Carolina, I think, as I understand it, depends on what other states may be able to draw down and have matching funds to draw down. And it's the same case in North Carolina. So therefore, what we have done over the years in terms of the block grants is we put those core program, those core services, like the Workforce County Block Grant and some of these other things, all the Child Protective Services pots of money that come out of there or go to SSBG, mm-hmm. We put all those things in the Workforce and into the TANF Block Grant. TANF contingency funds are exclusively now either child care subsidy or NC pre-K. Those are things that if TANF contingency goes up and down, then we can adjust those numbers up and down. But we want to try to protect our key core services in child welfare and our workforce county block grants and those sorts of things in the regular block grant. And even there, again, it's somewhat dependent on carry forward. It's somewhat dependent on what happens with cash assistance. I would say this, we will be looking at our projected carry forward. We will be looking at cash assistance again for next year. We will be looking at whether or not, we'd have any more than $300.9 million or $301 million available in the TANF block grant. And if so, then we'll be taking a look at what are the priorities for those funds. So I may have talked a little bit more about block grants than you wanted to hear, but that's TANF. Are any questions on TANF?
No.
Okay. Social services block grant. Just to say there, again, there was, I think, a slight decrease in that one as well. Don't think we'll see much of a change in the coming year. Although, like I said, same with TANF, we'll be looking at availability of funding. And then LIHEAP, again, our requirement is that we have 50% funding in special provision, 50% of the available funds for between LIHEAP and SIP. 50% for LIHEAP, 50% for CIP. David's going to give a report a little bit later in terms of a reallocation process on that. It was 60-40 last year, 60% LIHEAP, 40% CIP, and that has now switched to 50-50 this year. It'll be the same next year. CPS, Child Protective Services Funds, again, those pots of money that there are about probably 7 or 8 of them, or probably maybe 10, that if we look at the TANF block grant pots of money, if we look at transferred SSBG, and if we look at the state CPS dollars appropriated by the General Assembly in three different areas, we do not see any changes on the downward side from any of those next year. Right now, I think the estimates pretty much show that everything will remain as is. They're all locked in by formulas. And we will be and have begun, Kathy Samese and her folks have started looking at some of these pots of money with the idea that prior to the long session in 2017, we want to take a look at all of our pots of money, particularly in child welfare, and look at some kind of rebasing process. How should we allocate these funds? Because we've got formulas that are 20 years old. So that is a priority going forward. Budgeting for foster care expansion. This would be a good time for Kevin to come on over here just in case we get some questions on this, and I'm going to try to lead the conversation a little bit. As we know, foster care, it's in legislation. We'll be working on rules. We'll be working on policy to expand foster care effective January 1, 2017 to age 21. So first question then might be, what is the potential impact of foster care expansion on county DSS budgets? And I think to that intent, we need to say first of all that, as I understand it, Kevin, that for those children 18 and above, when we expand foster care, the cost of the board payment, the foster care payment itself, will be borne by the state and the federal government.
Correct.
So we will be looking at their 4E eligibility when they turn 18 and redetermining that. So basically, the impact on foster care payments of children that turn 18 or come back in to be on foster care to the county in terms of the payment will be zero. What other impacts are there? Well, the question then becomes, how many kids do you have on CARS agreement? CARS agreements, at this point in time, as I understand it, Kevin, are county and state dollars.
Correct.
Theoretically, therefore, if you have a 18-year-old right now who is on a CARS agreement and plans to be there on that CARS agreement on January 1, 2017, then that child becomes a foster child according to the criteria, and it would actually be a reduction in county dollars as far as that payment's concerned, because on January 1, 2017, I think I'm right, that payment would become state and federal rather than county, state.
I'm going to jump in
and add to
okay.
it.
Okay.
we know that we need to issue some policy around that, and we're trying to develop that policy now. Up until now, we've been working on administrative rules, which obviously have to be in place, according to the federal government, before we could move forward with that. What we are proposing, and since we don't have policy out, I'll be careful to say it's very much in draft and we want your feedback, is that we feel obliged to honor those contractual agreements for residential services even after January 1st, 2017. That's up for debate, and we certainly want to hear from you, but to honor that agreement with that young adult, we feel is important. On the other hand, what we really want to work towards is that the naming of this from CARS to foster care should be as least impactful on that young adult as possible. In other words, no more restrictive than we currently are is the goal. There will have to be a court action within 180 days of the youth signing their voluntary placement agreement, which is one difference, and that may not be the youth's desire. But what we hope is that we can honor those agreements moving forward, and then any new, call them reentries or engagements after January 1st would be under that foster care definition, with no maintenance costs on the side of the county, but administrative costs will continue to be borne primarily by the county with funds available as we can identify them. Federal, we think we can get up to about a 60% rate of eligibility. That's our best estimate, and that's why we chose the method of entry into foster care for a person after they reach 18 as a voluntary placement agreement with that very young, but still legally an adult. So I hope that helps a little bit.
Okay. I think one question might be, how does the county project the number of children that may elect to stay in foster care past age 18? My answer to that is, my experience as a parent and a grandparent is I can't predict anything that an 18-year-old is going to do, much less something as major as remaining in foster care. But I think to the point, though, I think on both the state level and really on the county level in terms of staffing, because the staffing part of this, maybe it's important to note, whereas we're looking at federal and state funds to pay for the cost of care, foster care payment, the staffing, the social work staffing time to work with those children past age 18, those young adults, would remain as it is, I guess, as far as the funding would be either 4E or not.
Right.
Yeah. So, and it's an issue with the state as well, because we're trying to budget our estimated state cost, you know, and certainly it would be an impact on our state because we'd be picking up the state cost and sharing it with the federal government, how many are 4E, how many are not. So we would be interested, I think, in any counties that may be able to do any kind of survey or interviews or, you know, with your 17-year-old population or your CARS kids.
Questions that came through. Will children still have the option to leave foster care at age 18 after January 1st, 2017?
Yes.
Okay.
They are adults when they turn 18. The legal definition of adult hasn't changed. So yes, if they believe they can support themselves when they turn 18, the court and everyone would recognize they're now legally an adult.
Second one, is Kevin saying honoring the agreement meaning counties will still bear the burden of the cost?
With the state, because currently CARS agreements on the maintenance side is 50% state, 50% county. Yes, we are proposing, and again, the philosophy is that we, the county, the system, has entered into a contract with a young adult. And while there are always provisions to end a contract, and if the counties collectively in the association feel that that's a better route to take, we'd certainly, as we develop policy, hear that. But our initial proposal is to not disrupt a signed contract between an agency and an adult until such time that young adult ceases to no longer take advantage of that service. Again, we know there's provisions in every contract to end it. If counties collectively feel that's a better route to go, we will hear that. We're just trying to respect the youth voice that we've heard up until now, and that is they've, in good faith, entered into an agreement with you, and that they may wish to continue that agreement. And maybe this is a case-by-case situation.
So I guess the follow-up question might be if a young adult likes the foster care plan, to go from cars to foster care, that same young adult at 18, 19, who's already on a contract, you choose to do that.
Or maybe even a little bit step further and has no objections.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Fair enough.
To be worked out in policy.
To be worked out. We luckily, and we thought we didn't have to fight hard. We knew we would need this time, so we're glad we're starting early, if this is early. Thank you.
Any other questions?
No other questions.
All right, I think we're through with budget, and we'll move right down to updates on our CFSR program improvement plan.
Great, that's a good transition then. Before I talk a little bit about the CFSR program improvement plan, I want to take just a second to acknowledge March is Social Worker Appreciation Month, and it's a difficult time for social workers in child welfare in particular. So please note we at the division appreciate social workers across the state doing what I believe is the hardest job to be done. So thank you for all you're doing. We'll try to continue to message that throughout the month. If you have activities planned, please let us know. We will echo and build upon those as we have capacity. So moving into the program improvement plan, I first also want to thank, as I've done in the past, 10 counties who really stepped up to the plate and conducted the case review portion of the CFSR and will continue to do so with partnership from the state. We have built back our capacity to pick up some of those responsibilities. That is probably could be said to be the primary means by which the program improvement plan activities will be measured. And then I also want to thank everyone across the state, counties, and other stakeholders who participated either in person or remotely in the report results dissemination meeting, with the Children's Bureau taking the lead in that on January 11th and 12th. Your thoughts, although that was a big meeting, your input has been used in the planning, and that's why you haven't heard from us in the week since then. We've been taking all of that material and trying to do our best diligent efforts to honor that, to find themes and groupings by which we can address all outcomes and all systemic factors that were identified in the Child and Family Services results report. We have come up with five groupings. As we talked about on January 11th and 12th, we had to make some very tough decisions about participants because we just couldn't have five groupings of 100 or so people together. We saw that wasn't going to be the most effective way to drill down into some of the details. So working with leadership in county directors of not just the Children's Services Committee, but many others, after last week's committee meeting, we identified individuals, and invitations are in the process of going out now. So again, if you're not on the invite list, please know that doesn't mean we didn't find your input valuable. We do. We just had to make those tough decisions, and those are being finalized, as I said, and meetings are – the logistics have now been set, and we will – disseminate the notes and the meeting results from all of those five work groups as quickly after that as we can. Obviously, we're under a schedule that the Children's Bureau has, and Congress, in fact, has mandated. So our final first draft of the PIP is due no later than May 2nd. Our goal, we have weekly contacts with the Children's Bureau, is actually to have a first draft for them to review later in March, and it will be very rough at that point. We're only giving ourselves 1 week following the five work group gatherings to provide that feedback. So after the meetings, there's going to be a lot of work done in parallel. We appreciate ongoing feedback and know we're trying to balance what is an awfully broad and deep scope of work and a broad and passionate audience and stakeholders. Can't thank you enough for all of the valuable input that you have. So the first work group meets next Monday, and then four more the following week. Fortunately, we've got a lot of resources from the department assigned to us to help us out with that. And again, we will disseminate those, that information as quickly as we possibly can. Email went out a couple days ago to all directors and all the email addresses we had from the participants on January 11th and 12th, summarizing the themes of those five work groups. So if you're interested in that, ask your director or a representative if you had one at the January 11th and 12th. I know not every county was able to have someone online or in person. That's where we are in a nutshell. No more questions?
No more questions.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you much. Good. Thanks, everybody.
Okay. Next up, we'll talk about Food Nutrition Services performance update, and I'll ask David to come over. David Locklear, and as far as our performance is concerned, we're making improvements. Our timeline has started out about 80, I think we're 83 in 84 in August, 83 September, something like that. We moved up 90%, and this is based on our weekly timeliness reports, real time. We averaged 90% in December and held 90% in January. There were a lot of other factors taking place, including holidays, inclement weather, and other things. But it looks like through I think through last week, well, it was the week before last week, we were at 92% in February. So if we can continue to move this up, I think we're going to be in a good place. One of the things I'm going to ask Angela Taylor or David Chobakini to talk about in a little while when we get to NC Fast is looking at the reports that we do on a weekly basis, because we do calculate 2 days for mailing. But we want to talk about those reports and what we're doing. We'll do that a little bit later. So I want to commend the counties for what's been happening. And what we're also going to do today, and David, I'm going to give it to you as far as any other comments on F&S performance, and then we're going to have a couple of county updates.
I think you said it well, Wayne. I'd like for us to go ahead and move in for the sake of time.
Okay.
The two counties that we've asked to speak
with. We've got two counties that I think are doing really good, so we've asked them to comment. We're going to start Rutherford County. DSS, I've noted on their weekly reports that they're not a large county, but they've got a good number of them per week of applications, and they've been 100% or 98 to 100% on a fairly consistent basis and doing a really good job. So I've asked John Carroll, I think we have Candy and Susan and Cheryl online to report on some of the best practices that Rutherford County has put in place.
We are here, Wayne. This is John and Candy, and so I'm just going to turn it over to Candy. She's our program manager, and we have two supervisors, and I think they're going to participate, so we appreciate the invitation.
Okay.
Okay, on the first one, DVR County stats, we just always like to see those numbers when other people are presenting, and so basically, that's just what that is. So we can go on to slide two, because I'm assuming you're going to send this out to everyone. Is that correct?
It goes to everybody. It's going to be available on.
It'll be posted on the
web.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's just go to slide two then. We just listed some of our common practices that I'm sure that other counties are doing as well. But we are really trying to focus on being more assertive and proactive verification gathering. We call employers. We call landlords. If a client doesn't have ID, we're more proactive about going to get that information. We use any resources available to us, either that be electronic or other records. And so we're just trying to be more proactive and train our caseworkers to be that way as well. Those days of just sending an 8650 and waiting are over, and we've adopted that and we've realized that. Our NC Fast pending application report is reviewed daily for our fourth and 25th day. And not only do we review this, we hold our workers accountable. We make them respond to the supervisor what is actually pending on those applications. And once we see that nothing is pending, we make sure they're disposed of immediately. Our application log is reconciled daily by our clerical staff. If the application is not opened up the next day, the worker is emailed and also the supervisor to make sure that that is opened. And we are specialized by program and functions in Rutherford County. We have specialized intake units and specialized reviewers as well. Our online application received work queue is reviewed. We push for 3 times per day and disperse immediately. Realistically, it's probably just twice, but we really push for 3 times, especially on Fridays and holidays. A task for EPAS applications are created for every application and forward to the assigned worker. We just don't want our processing days eat up by getting those the next morning, so we try to be very proactive in that as well. Our receptionist received intensive training on completeness of applications and our recertifications and necessary verifications. We really invested some time into our clerical staff and our front desk staff to just educate them on the food nutrition requirements. And they even partner with a client when they drop off a recert or an application. They look at the income part. If the client states that they have earned income, they go ahead and have a conversation with them. Do you have the wages with you? Sometimes they've even gone back to the car and got them, or they've dug them out of their purse. Just whatever it takes to get that information, even rent receipts. So we've just done some training in general with our staff to make them know what the caseworkers are going to need. The receptionist also asks for their email addresses from clients and adds this to the recertifications when available. But as we know, sometimes those phone numbers are not good for long, and we have been able to get in touch with some via email. Next slide. And David, we did eliminate our Dropbox over a year ago, and this has proven very beneficial for us here in Rutherford County. So we definitely agree with that suggestion you made for that. That just gives the front desk more room to proof our research for accuracy and signatures and prevents more pending of information. And of course, we require our workers to run work number for all applications awaiting our earned income verifications, and not just for applications, research as well. And we use any other web-based website, such as Verify Direct, to get any income that's out there. And I'm sure all counties are doing this. We are pushing for same-day processing. If the information is provided from that client, sometimes they're even written up on the clients in the office, so we really push for that. We use client statement when policy allows us to, such as if we got terminated income and it's outside the base period, then we do take client statements. So we use that as a friend. We encourage all of our income maintenance staff to ask for current phone numbers each time they speak with a client. And this is income maintenance wide. That's just part of our training and our dialogue with our clients every time we see them or we talk to them over the phone, just to make sure we've got a current phone number. And one of our best practices that we feel like has been the most beneficial for us in Rutherford County is we noticed that we were really struggling to get our interviews completed on our drop-off applications. So again, we trained our front desk staff. They give the notice of information needed, which is at $86.50, to all of our clients at the front desk. We do have one intake worker is assigned to drop-off. Our receptionist schedules the interview for the next business day, either that be by phone or in person, if the client states they can't be contacted by phone. And again, they just have to ask a few questions at the front desk. And we do encourage, if the client doesn't have a phone number, we encourage that client to stay and see a worker if possible, but sometimes they can't. And Susan ran some numbers for us, and since October the 19th, 2015, we've had a total of 201 drop-off applications. And only 9 notices for missed interview has been needed for those 201 applications. So I feel like that's been very successful for us. And another thing that's been successful for us is the next 2 slides, we're just really going to talk about how we thoroughly investigate any overdues at the end of the month. And for instance, our good cause and regulatory delay. What we found from those investigations that some of the workers were just processing and not really thinking about policy or why the reg delay was coming up. So now all workers must have a supervisor's approval for any case that asks for good cause. So the supervisor has to get it and they look at it immediately. Workers are not allowed to select a yes or no option without a supervisor's approval. And in most instances, we have found issues with the evidence that has created the reg delay, which was not really an overdue application. So this has helped us. And then just to segue into the next slide is we just thoroughly investigate all overdue cases. We don't just accept that we've had 2 or 3 overdue. We look at this as an opportunity to learn. Each overdue case is investigated to see why it's showing on the overdue report. We use this data from the investigations to manage going forward, and we train our staff on this. We evaluate how the system handles certain circumstances to prevent future overdues, because we're still learning this system, and we're learning how it applies to policy. And then we've started having individual conferences with caseworkers on our overdues to make them more accountable. And I just want to say, too, on our QC, we just recently got a QC error, and we rebutted that, and we won that. So just really take time to dig into these and see if it's truly overdue or what you can learn from them to help in the future. And the last is our late research. We have assigned these to one caseworker in most occasions because they do manage the evidence a little differently. And if the late research are dropped off, again, our front desk staff, they screen it for the interview, and they also screen for accuracy. And we also evaluate these the same day for expedited service, so that has really helped us as well. That's it.
Thank you. Good presentation, good practices. I was really noting the fact that you're proactive about getting the eligibility information. I think that's one of the best practices, David, that we've heard from other states that have succeeded very well in their timeliness as a practice to do it.
Candy, can I ask you one question? You talked about the receptionists do the 8650. If someone just wants to drop off the application, do you try to encourage them to stay for the interview, or you just make the appointment?
No, we do try to encourage them to stay. We always ask for them to stay.
Okay.
A couple of questions for you from online. How do you train your front desk staff?
Well, our front desk staff is under income maintenance, so we include them. Well, we actually had a special training just for them, and we went over the research and the application that mainly targeted certain areas such as the income, rent receipts, and things like that you usually have to pin for. And they've really adapted very well. And we also make them aware of any changes, such as the new SR has two signatures now. So we just made sure that we made them aware of that. So now they're looking for two signatures instead of one.
Another question, are receptionists classified as OA3s or IMC1s?
We are in the process of reclassifying them as IMC1s. Right now they're PA4s, which is the same pay as IMC1.
Okay.
And just a comment that we need more of these counties' best practice presentations across all the DSS programs.
Good point.
And Andy, I will, to that comment, share that we did send out later last year the list of best practices from across the state. So there is a document out there. I think it's a Dare County Director letter. From 2015 that has all county best practices listed there.
There's a question of will people get this PowerPoint? The recording of this webinar and all PowerPoints that were given will be posted on the internet, and the posting should be either today or tomorrow. And we'll send out a link to that posting where you can hear the recording and see all the presentations. Also, if Mecklenburg County, if Peggy Egan's there, I sent you an audio pin. You need to put in the pin so I can unmute you.
I think from Mecklenburg, and if there's no other questions, we'll move on. I think from Mecklenburg.
One more question.
Okay, one more question before we go to Mecklenburg.
Does Rutherford have a call center that is used in this process?
We do. We rotate our workers, and they take a phone duty one day a week.
Okay.
Thank you.
Candy, thank you. John, thank you both. Good work. Mecklenburg County, Min Chayez Ari is going to be our presenter, and Mecklenburg is our largest urban county. Mecklenburg has somewhere near 1,000 applications per week, or a little less, so about double any other county in any given week in the state. So they're very important, I think, to the process. But Mecklenburg has improved in their performance from maybe averaging somewhere in the mid to upper 80s to 93-94% here in the last 3-4 weeks. And so great, great work by Mecklenburg. So Min Chayez, are you there?
Mecklenburg should be on now.
You're here. Could you hear us?
Yes. Rodney?
This is Rodney Adams. Peggy had to step out. Min Chayez Ari is here. He's going to walk us through what we've been doing here in Mecklenburg.
All right. Good morning, everyone. What I like to start out with is just a little bit of background on how we got here. We were fortunate to be able to attend to the APHSA Staff Directors Conference and then stay over after the conference and travel and visit some DSSs in Seattle. And I think the main thing that happened from making that trip, we were able to connect with other states who are successful. We were able to meet peers who have gone through what we've gone through, who have difficulty in achieving some of the timeliness, and basically share some of the things that they were doing. And from the Mecklenburg perspective, it was very good to meet some people who had similar caseload sizes and had to serve, serve the urban populations like we did. So it was really some very good connections that were made. And from that trip, I think the biggest takeaway that we had is that 95% timeliness is possible. If you do not start with that basis, I don't think that this work is going to be, we're not going to be able to do it. And so once we were able to acknowledge that 95% timeliness is possible, we then had to change the mindset of our staff and our managers. So we really started with talking with our managers and really saying that it was possible. We had to eliminate from our vocabulary all references to 7-day and 30-day. And then we really looked at what parts of our business processes needed to be changed, because some of our processes really were in support of the old mindset. And so we really began to implement some business process reengineering, and we'll talk a little bit about that. I think one of the main things that was shared with the other colleague that just presented was the importance of a reporting. So we have a daily application tracker report that we take from NCFAST, and we import it in Excel, and we share it with all of the supervisors. And they have to basically give a report of their cases 3 days out. We go 3 days out because on Friday we want to make sure that we know the status of the cases going over the weekend. And very similarly, they have to tell if a case is pending, why it's pending. One of the things that we learned from other counties is they don't allow them to pend unnecessarily. They put expectation of pending no more than 25% of your cases. And so we really have that expectation that if you're going to pend a case, we want to know why it was pended, and we want to make sure that it's not pended unnecessarily. And so by 3 p.m. every day, managers have to give a status update on where their cases are. And cases that are pending, I have a worker who does follow-up activities. So the main thing that cases are pending for here, as I'm sure they are in your areas, is wages or interviews. So once we understand the status of the case, we have someone who spends all day trying to contact that customer by phone and or trying to reach third parties or the employer to get that wage information. Another thing that we've done is we have really begun the process of removing this distinction of the front and back end of our organization. We have been set up for a number of years to have intake and case management, and that specialization by function has kind of crippled us. It has not allowed us to be flexible when we need more hands on deck in the back end or when we need more hands on deck in the front end. So we are removing the barrier of talking in terms of intake and case management, and we've reorganized ourselves to have managers supervise both intake teams and case management teams, and then we're looking at how to meet workload challenges from a team perspective and not necessarily from a functional perspective. That began February 1st. We have also repurposed our change team, and we call them a critical response team. And our critical response team is basically a team of folks who do not have a caseload, and their job is to provide support in any area of the organization that's needed. So in terms of case management, they can provide support in the case management area, the intake area, for all programs. And because, as you know, the biggest challenge to completing a strategy is you have, there's a monkey wrench that's always thrown in. So we were working on timeliness, and then we've got a task of checking all the ABODs. You're working on timeliness, and then you had to work on Medicaid conversions. And so the critical response team is there so that we're able to adhere to our strategy and not be distracted with some of the other things that just come as a natural course of the business that we're doing. We have increased the level of accountability to the team level. Very similarly, we look at every single case and we understand, we want to know why it was overdue. There's an expectation that all of the reports are updated timely. If the reports are not updated by 3 p.m., we are actually going to documentation with our staff on that. I mean, we've had written coaching with our supervisors, and if you have one or two written coaching, you never have to worry about these reports not getting done timely. And so everyone takes this very seriously. We've had staff meetings where we met with every single staff person who does food stamps and really talk to them about what is on the line, talk to them about where we are, and shared our status each and every week with them. So everyone is bought in, and everyone is vested, and they understand the penalties that we face if we don't meet this. And then lastly, we really have reduced pending, you know, just in our normal language, everyone says, oh, I've got to pend this case. It's not necessarily pending. You need to screen the case. And if there's something that you need to proactively try to get that verification first, as opposed to just automatically defaulting to pending. And we really are holding people to watching the language that they have around the activities around FNS processing. We've also got rid of our Dropbox. We have someone there who's ready to interview on the spot if someone comes and wants to drop off an application. And the vast majority of folks who drop off their documentation stay for the interview because, as you all know, word of mouth is the most is the best thing that we have on our side. And once the clients can understand that, they can come in and come out with a decision on their case, they're coming with the documentation. We're starting to see that. Next slide. So some of the changes that we've done to our business process is to achieve the 95%, and you see that it's still a work in progress because we really just launched this in February. So on January 1, we implemented a soft launch for same-day processing. Prior to January, our staff would interview for all programs, and then they would pass those cases off to a team of processors. And so what we've begun, beginning January 1st, all FNS cases, whether expedite or not, the goal is that they will be completed on the same day. And so we had to retrain our staff. We had to provide support for them. But the goal and expectation is that if that case is ready, it can and will be written up that day. And the expectation is also that you will proactively look for wage information, if needed, so that that client is not needing to come back. We also made divisional changes, as I mentioned earlier. We reorganized our management team, so all of our managers have some food stamp workers on their team. We've also managed to get rid of the distinction between the intake side and the case management side. Our goal is to achieve two program people have proficiency in two programs and two functions, and we've outlined a training plan that will take us over the next year and a half that will get us to that place. We've designed new reports, and we consistently meet with the staff, letting them know where we are and how we progressed in the changes. Next slide. This is, I think, really what happens is as we began to make the changes, it took a little while for us to see the results in our numbers, and we just held fast to the principles. And I wanted to just show how implementing the changes, how it has impacted our timeliness percentages. So if you see the late December, early January, the first graph, we were at 83.8%. We did the soft launch of same-day process in January 1, and you see the next week we went to 85. And from that week on, with the exception of 1 week in January, we have been in the low to mid-90s with the expectation of hitting and maintaining 95% timeliness. If you flip to the next slide, this really shows our monthly growth. So in October, our average was 82%. November, we went to 84%. January, when we did our soft launch, we went to 88%. And so far in February, we're at 93.4% as it relates to timeliness. And the expectation is that we will get to 95% and stay there. This last slide really shows how we've done with same-day processing. And the numbers that are listed here are just the applications for face-to-face, including in these numbers aren't the mail-ins and walk-ins, although we are working on getting those done same-day, but we really wanted to focus on same-day face-to-face interviews. So in January, we did the soft launch. 56% or 1,098 cases were completed on the same day that they were interviewed. And in February, you'll see that that increased to 77%, or we did 1,426 cases on the same day that they were interviewed. And that's the strategy that we're going to. The expectation is 100%, the staff are vested and they're on board. Every Monday, they get an email stating where our percentage is. People are waiting for that email. They're excited about it. And they're really on board to do what they can do to help us get 95%.
I think that's it, Wayne.
And Jayez, thank you very much. I'm hearing some common themes here, I think, that focused on the same day. I think being aggressive about getting documentation to get the work done, kind of not having that drop-off box, but having a better system of doing that, what you're doing at the front desk, your reorganization of your structure, and accountability. But I think having the team involved as well, when you're talking about reports, so everybody sees how they're doing, everybody sees how the team's doing, the unit's doing, the agency's doing. I think I'm hearing some common themes from Rutherford as well as Mecklenburg. Questions?
Two questions. Is there an information release form signed when the application is filled out so the workers can leave messages on the phone?
We do have a regular release of information that is done. One of the things, I'm glad you asked that question, one of the best practices that we got from Seattle is something that we share, and we've had great success with that, where we aren't having to leave messages, is that the clients oftentimes have personalized their ringtones, and as many of us have, and so when a customer gets a call from our agency, it's a ringtone, it's a number that has not been programmed, so the standard ringtone goes. And what we've learned is if we leave a message saying, this is Min Chayez from Department of Social Services, please call me, I'm going to call you back in 5 minutes. The majority of clients are picking up the calls because they realize, oh my gosh, that was DSS, I should have grabbed that call. And so we aren't having to leave so many messages. And the other thing that prevents us from having to do that is we have an employee who calls numerous times once we've tried to get that verification right around the 22nd or 23rd day or the third day, so that we are able to speak directly with that client. But we just have a standard release of information form that we have people sign.
Couple other questions?
Yeah, second question is, what's the average caseload since they've been doing same-day processing?
The people who interview don't have a caseload. They have an expectation of interviewing 8 to 10 customers. When we did the same-day processing, what we did not do is we did not lower the expectation. That was one of the hardest things for the supervisors to adhere to. The staff were really saying, wait a minute, you're giving me more work, and I still have the expectation to interview the same number of people, and we held that. What we told them is that if we noticed that you needed additional time, we'd make adjustments. And what we have found is that they're still doing their 8 to 10 interviews as they had prior to same-day processing, and so we have not had to decrease that at all. So for our interviewers, it's 8 to 10 cases that they're expected to interview each day.
And then one last comment. Mecklenburg County, you rock, 77%. Same-day processing is the way to go.
Well, thank you.
Amen.
And Wayne, I'll just add, Mecklenburg, it was a great experience for Mecklenburg to be able to do the visit in Seattle. I actually visited with them. And there will be an opportunity this year. This year, the APHSA conference will be in Orlando, Florida in October. And I will be sharing that information with the state of North Carolina. And I'm happy to say in 2017, that conference will be held in Charlotte. National conference. I have asked that it be brought here in 2017, mm-hmm. so we will be hosting that conference. So.
Great opportunity.
Yeah.
Thank great you, opportunity. Good. Thank you. I thank all our folks in Mecklenburg and Rutherford County. Good work. And we've got other counties doing good work, too. I think we average from 18 to 25 counties that are 100% on any given week in terms of timeliness. And, you know, certainly follow up, you know, with the slides, I want to thank Peggy and Rodney Minchayes. I want to thank Candy. I want to thank John and Rutherford, John Carroll, director. Good work, and we'll get more of this and to share on future calls. Move along, ABOD implementation updates, David.
Okay, real quickly for the sake of time, and we're running out of time here, just wanted to refer everyone back to the DSS Administrative Letter 5/2015 that was dated 12/17 regarding ABODs. Things are going okay with the 23 counties. We will be implemented in the 77 counties effective July 1. However, those 77 counties, it is imperative that you begin now. Today is March 1, so any application that you're taking, your certification period will run through the July timeframe when you're going to begin implementing the ABOD provisions in your county. So I want to encourage you to go back and review that administrative letter 12/17/15. We are working on a Dear County Director letter and an admin letter that we hope to get out by Friday of this week. Which will apply to all counties in regards to what you need to be doing now, specifically the 77 counties. You need to begin doing an analysis or an assessment of every individual that's a potential ABOD that you are interviewing beginning today. So we will get some information out, some additional information out on that. We also will be doing additional training for the 77 counties. The operational support team later last year provided some webinars. Those webinars are out there in the Learning Gateway in NCFAS, so I encourage you to review those webinars now. The other thing I was going to mention in regards to ABODs is we are having some ongoing conversation with legal aid, and we are making some assessments, making some policy changes. If you notice, there effective March 1, there was a policy change in section FNS policy 245. It's change number 4-2016, which was effective today. Actually, it was effective on the date it was issued. So it was just some clarifications regarding the ABOD policy. So I encourage you to go back out and look at that policy that was effective today. For the 23 counties, we will be, in the next few days, we will be corresponding some updated information regarding the ABODs, and I won't go into a lot of details on that today on the call because we're still finalizing some things, but we hope to have out a Dear County Director letter, admin letter, again by the end of the week, clarify any new issues regarding the ABOD provisions.
Two questions. One, first, will the state provide an assessment tool for FNS counties to use?
That is one of the things we're working on that we hope to get out to you by Friday.
Can we get a list of all the ABODs for the counties?
Another issue that's been worked on, and I'll ask Angie when she does her update, if they can provide an update on where we are on getting the list out to the counties.
And was there an ABOD change, an administrative letter, or a manual change?
There was a manual change for 2016, which was effective today. And then the admin letter I referenced was dated December 17th of 2015. And then there will be an admin letter and a Deer County letter going out later this week. Okay. The only other thing I was going to mention real quick, Wayne, was the LEAP reallocation. For those that have not seen the Deer County direct letter dated February 23rd, we did send out the reallocation survey that is due to us by the end of the day tomorrow. So please, if you're interested in reallocating any crisis or LIHEAP dollars back that you don't feel you're going to use, and if you're interested, if you're a county that has exhausted your funds and you want to request additional funds, we need that survey back by the end of the day. If you don't get it back by close of business tomorrow, we will be moving forward with the reallocation on Thursday. So we got to have that. One of the things I've had many questions is, if we reallocate dollars back to the state, will that impact our reallocation for future years? And the answer to that is no. The allocation for SIP and LIHEAP each year is based on the county poverty levels in each county and the F&S caseload for each county. So we don't look at any other factors when we're determining the amount of your allocation. We do anticipate for the 16-17 fiscal year, and Wayne may have mentioned this earlier, we do anticipate a reduction in the LIHEAP block grant. I'm not sure at this point we know the amount of that, but we do anticipate a slight reduction in those dollars for 16-17. Okay?
All right. Thank you, David. What's going on?
Wayne, one other thing, real quick.
Yeah.
Epics, there was an admin letter that went out regarding Epics. So those of your program integrity staff, it's imperative that they review this letter. It's admin letter 2-2016.
Yeah, that's important. Thank you, David. I've asked Hank Bowers to do a presentation here, a little bit of information for counties about our day sheet pilot project. We've got some counties doing a pilot, and asked Hank to give us an update. Hank?
Good morning. I'm going to give a little overview of how we got to this point and what the future plans are. And as you may recall, in preparation for conversion to NC FAST for Economic Services Program, we asked county workers, economic services workers, to start using the DSS 4263 to code their time as opposed to the old white day sheets. One of the advantages of that being that their time could be included in the process where counties can upload the results of the day sheets into what was then the Maximus Tech application and have that transferred over to the percentages on the 1571 process. We also were doing that with the idea of implementing the NCFAS Client Services Data Warehouse day sheet interface, which we're in the process of piloting now. So under Plan B, which we implemented back in July of 2013, workers were to code their time to service codes 890, 891, and 892 with specific program codes. And they would use the program codes based on the primary focus of their action, either what the applicant said they wanted to apply for, or if they were going in to make an action on the case, and they knew it was for Medicaid, that sort of thing, they would code to program code MA, for example. And the issue of Plan B is, with NCFAS, workers know what they're doing and how long it takes them, but they don't necessarily know which or how many product delivery cases are impacted by the results of their actions. This creates issues for accurate coding of time to specific fund sources or the program codes. So Plan A was the idea to capture the impact of the workers' actions in NC Fast on product delivery cases and utilize the data from NC Fast to allocate their recorded time across the applicable programs. And this was a concept similar to how random moment sampling works, where you contact a worker and ask what they're doing right now, and then apply the results of that survey to all the workers in the county. In this instance, we'd be looking at actual data from NC Fast on number of completed applications and recertifications and active cases in a county, and applying that to worker time recorded during the month. And one of the goals of this is to reduce day sheet coding burden on the county staff using NC Fast. So to give you an overview of the process of the interface, workers code their time that they spend actively using NC Fast to the same service codes as used in Plan B, but with a generic program code, NCF. So instead of coding 890 MA or 890 FS, they would just code 890 to NCF for a block of time. And the two charts here illustrate how that works. On the left side, they've got, for instance, 90 minutes worth of 890 time broken out among various program codes, but they would just code a single line to 890 with program code NCF for 90 minutes under Plan A. So the interface at the end of the month takes all the time that's been recorded on day sheets and pulls out all of the time coded to 890, 891, and 892 with NCF. And then it also receives data from NC Fast on the number of active cases, the number of research processed, and the number of applications processed by program for the month by the for the county. And then it calculates percentages of those, and then applies those percentages to the time coded by the workers. So for the instance in our example where we had 90 minutes of 890 time coded to NCF, it takes the percentages for active cases from NC Fast and applies that to the 90 minutes, and you end up with what looks like a regular time record that would have been coded by the worker. And then it takes that time after it runs through that process for 890, 891, and 892, and then inserts those records back into the county data prior to running the month-end process where all the reports are produced and the output file, which is used to import into TEC, is created. So as far as what will change and what the expected impacts might be, the interface will impact only time coded to 890, 891, or 892 NCF. All the other day sheet coding will be left alone and will be processed as usual. The upper management here at DHHS made a decision that all workers using NC Fast in the pilot counties for now should code 890, 891, and 892 time to NCF on their day sheets. Again, the thinking is that even though they may be what people call a specialized worker working on food stamp applications or something like that, the results of their action could be other product delivery cases. So in the same way that all the survey results are applied to all the workers in random moment sampling, we're going to try the same thing with our Plan A interface. If your county FTPs your day sheets, it's vital that you submit your file successfully and before the cutoff. We're actually working on a process now. Well, this is always the case. We always need your data before the cutoff, but we do have a process in place if something unforeseen comes up and your data doesn't make it in, where we can create a single county percentage of time report and the data input file for import into TEC. And from what I understand, our tech folks over at DHHS think we'll be able to implement a similar process using the interface. You'll likely see some changes in the allocation of costs for worker time under the interface, and we'll talk about that more in a minute. Another change is when we first implemented Plan B, we told county workers to code all their work first employment and cash assistance time to program code 9 or MOE. Under the changes that are coming out now, today actually, we're going to ask income maintenance workers using NCFAS to code work first employment services time to program code R or 100% federal TANF, and continue to code their cash assistance and emergency assistance time to program code 9. We are establishing, or in the process of establishing, new application codes which will allow the county finance officer to move costs from TANF to MOE for the work first employment services, or from MOE to TANF for cash assistance. And there'll be some instructions coming out from the controller's office on that later this month. The other change is that when you're using the what is now NC Corels, formerly Maximus Tech application, you will not need to apply a penetration rate for 891, 892, and 890 coded to program code HC or health choice, because the interface will determine the appropriate percentages when it runs the data through the process. And that will come out on the data file that you import into the NC Corels. So there will no longer be a need to apply that penetration rate to those codes. So it's a little, maybe a little hard to see. I hope you can see it better than I can. But I looked at January day sheet data, January 2016, to compare the percentages of worker time under Plan B, where they coded directly to program codes, to that from Plan A, which we ran through the process. And to make a long story short, you do see some changes under foods. Well, if you're looking at the first row is applications, you can see that food stamp and MA time increased slightly. We had a drop in health choice time and in MOE time, but SA also increased slightly, very slightly, and refugee Medicaid and refugee cash assistance were insignificant as far as changes. Research, similar process or similar result. And then for case management, we've got a very significant increase in the Medicaid percentages. Again, a decrease in health choice and slight decrease in MOE and SA time percentage. But overall, we did see a slight drop in the food stamp percentage of time, pretty good sizable increase in the Medicaid time with a almost as large drop in health choice time. If you look across all the programs, however, the percentage, the difference between Plan B and Plan A was something like 4 to the minus 15. So it was almost insignificant difference between the two methods. However, if you go to the next slide, Curtis Crouch in our controller's office took a look at the differences in the result of allocation of costs based on the two different methods. And what you see here are the program codes on the left, the different fund sources, and their FP percentages. In the green columns, you'll see the current method and how things worked out. And this is statewide. Counties pulled down a total of $43,248,804 roughly in federal dollars. And I'm sorry, in the actual 1571 amounts, and the federal share was $26,245,889. When we simulated the results of the interface on that same data, we did see some changes. Of course, the same total amount. The federal share actually increased by about $1 million, a little over. We did see some changes. Lost some federal dollars in special assistance. Well, there is no federal dollars in special assistance, but we lost some reimbursement in SA. Lost some in Medicaid. Also in TANF, but we picked up quite a bit in food nutrition services, a little bit in health choice, and to a lesser degree, refugee Medicaid. Also reduced in Medicaid transportation. We're looking into the reasons for a lot of this, but primarily it appears to be that these programs that are negatively impacted the most are such a small portion of our overall case and application and research activity, with the exception of Medicaid. But you see increases in research and decreases in apps, and then reverse for for Medicaid or FNS, and it's kind of, they cancel each other out, and in the long run, it appears like we're going to increase revenue across the board. So we're going to keep a close eye on this, and there are a couple of issues that we're a little concerned about, because Work First is such a small portion of all the activity in NCFAST. There is a potential for it to impact the amount of MOE that would be allocated as a result of this process. I looked at the data in January, and statewide, the amount of MOE coming from the 890 series was about 25% of the overall MOE, which could be a significant impact if things don't balance out a little bit more. But that's what we're running the pilot for. We're going to take a look at these issues and come up with a plan to ameliorate any issues that might come up. For example, maybe exclude Work First from the Plan A coding, that sort of thing.
You've got five pilot counties, right?
That's right. Five pilot counties, Guilford, Lenore, Martin, Orange, and Wake. So we've got a good combination of size and complexity. So.
We've got questions.
More questions. Would Plan A adversely impact some counties? Most of the time, these type changes benefit some counties at expense of others. Is that a major concern?
Well, there certainly will be differences among counties. We've seen in the test data that we've been running since about October, I guess, some counties benefiting, some counties may have some negative changes. That's the reason we want to run the pilot and make a decision as to whether we want to actually implement this statewide or not.
Or whether we need to tweak it a little bit.
That's right. There may be changes that we could make that would get rid of any negative impacts that might arise.
Another question. How is time captured for reporting what is outside of the NCFAST working environment that can be attributable to 890, 891, and 892?
Our guidance has always been, if you're actively working in NCFAST, you would code time to these codes. That with a little leeway, if you're doing something that's directly related to what you're doing in NCFAST, if you're over here getting some copies made or that sort of thing, that would be okay to include in that time, but typically, this is going to capture most of the workers' time, I think. There are other service codes for work time. There's non-eligibility activity code. I think it's 872 that workers can use.
Another question, has this been calculated without the 75% Medicaid reimbursement level to see a flat change?
Yes, that's what the example that Curtis did included, that 75% Medicaid reimbursement in those calculations. So it's kind of odd. You would expect with the changes that we've seen that you might lose a lot of overall reimbursement, but the so far what we've seen is that it balances out, and at least at statewide level, we're seeing more federal participation.
Last question, will NCFES interface with Information Inc.?
I'm not quite sure what that question is saying, but Information Inc. should be able to apply these changes just like they do any other day sheet change for those any of those five counties that are participating in the pilot, and it will work exactly the same way. We tried to design this to have minimal impact on current processes and try to make it as transparent as possible, with the exception of the workers coding differently.
Okay, I think there was a follow-up to that one about the 75% Medicaid reimbursement. The person is asking, without the 75%. Your answer?
Well, the Medicaid transportation is at 50%, and that's included in there. I'm not quite sure what the question is referring to without 75%.
Yeah, I mean, 50% Medicaid
eligibility
program
is
program integrity or program integrity outreach or.
Well, program integrity would be using different service codes, so they shouldn't be impacted. And the non-eligibility service code is not impacted by this process either.
How about if 75% ended?
We would apply whatever the current.
Just for the record, 75% Medicaid for eligibility is the new 50, and there's nothing out there that would indicate that it will change.
That's right.
It's ongoing.
And just going back to a question that was asked earlier regarding work not captured in NCFAS, such as inquiries, when a client chooses not to apply for Medicaid, how will this be tracked?
Well, I would believe that if they withdrew their application, we would get that data from NCFAS and it would be included in the counts. If there was just a choice not to apply, then that, I think that would be a non-NCFAS type activity.
Sometimes you get long-term care and inquiry sample.
Yeah.
That was it.
Okay. Thank you, Hank.
One other thing.
Yeah.
We did issue CNSIS 0116 manual change yesterday, and that describes the implementation of the pilot for those five pilot counties, and it also addresses the fact that we'd like all workers not in the pilot counties to code their work first cash employment services time to 890, 891, 892R instead of 9. So if you haven't seen that yet, look for it. We did send out a listserv message, and I sent out emails to all the folks on my personal list. So. And let me know if you have questions.
Thank you, Hank. Segue right into our NC Fast update. Angela Taylor and her team.
Hi, this is Angela. So moving on to our, I'll go pretty quickly so that we've got about 15 minutes. So and then we'll just follow up with questions afterwards. So our next slide here, which is our readiness and reporting update. As most of you know, our next champion call will be on March the 16th. We'll go into a lot more detail around some of these items covered here. We also have been asked to provide some SDX follow-up training, so we're working on that, and hopefully we'll have that in the next 2 weeks. We're working with Harnett County and some others counties that have the health have choice and universal health care management, and resolving some of their issues around some of their claims. So we're actively working with them and others, and working with DMA to go back and look and work with providers. Again, we're going to treat this just like we did with SA. So we'll be working with county directors as we identify
needs for you to take a look at some of these activities around processing applications that may be impacting claims. So we're going to be doing the same thing in the Medicaid side. Then moving on down, we've had several reports that have been released or plan to be released, and I will encourage you to go out and look at some of the work support strategies reports. And we also have been going to the regional directors meetings, and OST has been assisting us. Carl Purcell has been providing some key information on where to find these reports, whether they're in NCFAST, O&M, whether they're in Exporter, or if they are in the data warehouse. Moving on to the next slide, this is our O&M update. Next slide, please.
Andy.
Sorry.
Okay.
Andy's sleeping at the wheel. All right.
Yeah.
So just so everyone knows, our next release is planned for March the 12th. We've got some key things that are going in right now, some ABOD future notice batch pieces, lots of ABOD, the defects that are remaining. We put some in last month, planning to put the remainder in coming up. And also, we are going to be updating USDA ABOD IEG for NCFAST and EPAS, and that's related to what David was speaking about as far as for the ABOD counties. I will share that we're currently for the for the remaining 77 counties that our problem in NCFAST is that they do not have any eligibility individuals that are subject to ABOD rules right now, so it's hard for us to identify those individuals. We're working with David's staff to identify the criteria for the potential ABODs, and we also have been asked by USDA for the same information, so we'll make sure that we're working closely with David's staff to identify those that we think are potential ABODs. Again, you'll have to go back in, just like the 23 did, and work some of those to make sure that the information is updated adequately to then actually determine whether they are or not ABOD. So we'll be providing a lot of that information and clarification as we did with the 23 when we went live with those. I will also share with the timeliness. We currently have 45 counties that are 95 or above for our FNS timeliness. Of those, 19 counties are at 100%. So great job. I know it's with what Rutherford and Mecklenburg have shared, a lot of counties are working diligently to improve, and it's showing with the numbers. So we'll continue to work with you all. With that said, we have 124 defects that we've resolved since our last release, and we're planning some additional defect resolutions for our March release on the 12th. Key thing is this very last piece, is that for our USDA timeliness report, for those that are just teetering close to the 75%, I think what I'm about to tell you will get you over that threshold. We have gone and run. One of the things that has been requested is, hey, we've got lots of clients that come in and tell us they already have a card. So we have been able to start capturing that information. We are finding that 60% of those that we are sending over on a nightly basis say that they already have a card. So what we will be doing is we're going to be changing. If that individual has indicated that they have a card, we will no longer add 2 days for mailing, which will then improve our timeliness statewide. So our plans are to be able to get that in. We're running a report today to make sure we'll have David's staff review that to ensure that everything's adequate and correct. And hopefully by next week, you'll be able to see those reports. And our plans are, as much as we can go back, we will go back and adjust those for the files that we have from our EBT vendor to make sure that we are adjusting those percentages. So some of you that have been very close in certain weeks, we should be able to get there. For the reports that you'll see that come out in the executive deck that came out last Friday, I believe we were at 92%, but we also had about 42 counties within that week. That was the week that we had some snow. So I'm hoping that the information you'll get this coming Friday will show us at a much better state. All right. With that, we'll move on down to slide number 4. This is our P3 updates. So I'll kick it over to David and let him provide quick updates on that.
Good morning. Just a few quick updates on Project 3, timeline-wise, and I think our timeline is at the end of our slides this time. The project continues to make progress towards the May go-live of the provider portal and functionality to follow on the heels of the provider portal for the child care application processing scheduled with the pilots, first in the July timeframe, and then, as Jennifer and Wayne covered earlier, September and October for the phase one and phase two rollouts. The P3 team is heavily involved in development and then a lot of effort on the testing of that functionality right now. And then obviously the readiness and training teams are attached, trying to put together any material that we can share to explain what's coming. The readiness team has been conducting those workshops. As Jennifer mentioned, we've conducted seven already. There was one this morning, and there's a final workshop on Thursday. Every county has been invited, and I think we've had almost everyone attend their scheduled dates so far. We have had good feedback on those, and thank you for the participation, and have had a lot of good questions. NCFAST continues to work in conjunction with DCD to issue materials for providers. We actually have two bulletins posted to the DCD website right now. A third on the way to be released in mid-March, and actually about an 18-page document called the Provider Preparation Guide, which we have sent over to DCD to post, and hopefully that'll be up within the next day or two. But this walks providers through basically everything from getting or what they're going to need to do to set up direct deposit to enrollment in the provider portal to the timeline and where they're going to be able to go for help and support. So there is a lot of information being shared with providers, and we are having some conversations about how to further enhance our communications to the provider community. On the energy front, the SIP and LEAP functionality, the designs for that is progressing. We have a lot of the documentation for functional designs happening right now. And the team is planning out, definitely keeping in mind the short processing time requirement for those two programs when they're working through those designs. That's just a brief overview on P3, and it looks like we now have P7 updates.
All right, so this is Angela again. I'll hit P7 and P4, and then we'll open it up for questions. So for P7, I think a question came up about online change of circumstance. We're currently working on the first release of that online through ePass. There will be five counties that we've started reaching out to some counties that will be our pilots. The first wave of this, so everyone understands the change of circumstance, will be around MAGI. We're waiting for the release from CURM to provide us some new functionality that will assist us with secure inbox as well, so we're working through that. That release from CURM was supposed to be here at the end of February. It is now March that we'll receive that, so we're working to adjust that timeline for the remaining pieces of change of circumstance. So, but we will release the first piece, which is receiving that information back in from the FFM and processing. Second piece here in the ePass world is online verification that is planned. We're currently scheduling and doing our testing with USCIS, and this is the SAVE piece of online verification, so we're working on that piece. We are also working with David and others and DMA to look at providing the TALKS interface, and so we're working on that as well. So that's another piece that's not listed here, but we are working on that. And then finally, our last release, we provided reasonable opportunity was implemented, and we also are working towards the 1095B IRS interface, which is due by June 30th, but we're hoping to be able to have that in hopefully by the May timeframe. Moving on to slide number six, where we are right now, most of you are aware, we have sent out about two-thirds of our forms already. Our plan is to have all of those forms completed and mailed out by the 14th of March, which is well under the timelines for the March 31st deadline from IRS. Also, the call center here at the state has been handling all the call volumes. Everything seems to be working fine now. We had a few little hiccups with phone service, but that has been mitigated. So we coordinated, that's a coordination between NC Fast, our print center, and the call center, and it's working very well. And sounds like a lot of the things around the help desk are have improved. Now, there's a lot of information that's available to folks. They're getting a stuffing with the 1095B to give them some frequently asked questions, as well as pointing them to the website that will provide them some additional information. Moving on down to slide number 7, this is our project 4. Some key things to understand, we did our project kickoff meeting, which was held on the 7th with our county directors, and we've had a follow-up meeting to make sure that they understand the commitment and what we're looking for staff. We reached out to the 9 counties that were a part of the original Child Welfare Committee. To engage those folks that were very diligent in helping us with the business plan. We also had a meeting yesterday with our state level folks over at DSS, Kevin Kelly's group, who's also being pulled in 2 or 3 different directions to talk about the commitment that we need from the state level SMEs and what that expectation and their participation will be with the NC Fast project. So we're currently working with the EAS work groups. Our plan is probably to establish a few more that are related around Project 4 because of some of the things that we need to move forward with. Again, key things there is conversion for P4, standardization around forms and what forms are going to be continuously needed or not needed based on the information in NC Fast. And then the big one there is mobility for those devices. A lot of folks are moving forward with, you know, purchasing, so they really kind of need to know what our plans are. So we're trying to finalize some of that as far as device. And putting some policies, I believe the work group has put together some very good documentation that hopefully we'll be able to share out with everyone. Finally, we also have finalized all of our amendments, and we have gotten staff starting to roll onto the project. We do have our senior PM. We have a PM from IBM. We also have Essential Resources on board, and we also have another state-level project manager that will be coming on board March 7th. So lots of activity, lots of we're reaching out to a lot of retirees, like probably all of you are, trying to find as many child welfare folks to become part of the NC Fast team that have knowledge about North Carolina and the way that we do business. We're continuing all those efforts, and then finally, we will start the kickoff with the resources that have been identified. I think today is the deadline for the counties to provide us their staffing, and then this coming Friday will be for the state level to provide us the subject matter experts so that we can kick off on the 14th through the 16th for our first fit gap analysis. So if we move on down to slide number 8, this is the current timelines for all the projects that we've discussed previously, and as you can see, where we are within each one of those. All right? So with that, I will open it up for questions.
We do have one long message that came through. A point of contact staff are being told by the help desk that they cannot file help tickets on known defects. Recently, having a help ticket on FNS application justified the case situation for the BAVDT report. We've seen value of having all help desk tickets accepted as they provide justification and verification that the county cannot complete an action timely. Additionally, as the number of help desk tickets is being reported out by NC Fast as an indicator of performance, we're concerned that NC Fast system messages discouraging filing help tickets and help desk discouraging our POCs from filing a ticket will give a skewed evaluation of the performance as it impacts at the county level. How will NC Fast know how many cases and the impact on individual counties and cases if help tickets are not accepted or being discouraged?
So I think that requires a lot more feedback. So what I would ask is, Andy, if you will take that, I will take that question offline. And I will provide out to all directors the answer to that question, because it's a multitude of things that have been asking that, and there's a lot of detail, and we've been working with the help desk and refinement. As most of you know, there's the lean event that Sherry has talked about, and they've looked at some process improvements, have worked with three counties that came on board, and there's some suggested changes all the way from the POC all the way up to the state level that we'll share. Unaware of discouragement, I'll have to go back and identify, is that one person? Is that, you know, a multitude? I do not know. I'm unaware of that. So I will take that offline and try to find out, you know, specifics around this and get that answer back out to all directors. And I think I've shared with the directors as well that one of the efforts that we're doing is also looking at and sharing with each county. And I think if you'll look in the executive deck that goes out every Friday, we have started including the total number of tickets that you have in that list. So we are trying to share back with you all of the information to make sure it's relevant. And we're also working on a third report to be able to provide, is that how many of those tickets are actually impacting the timeliness report. So we are working on that report as well to show that here's the things that are basically already untimely that are setting with a ticket, so that you can, as directors, can identify which ones are impacting your numbers. So we're hoping to be able to get that out in the next few weeks. Hopefully by the time you all are here in Raleigh or we're doing the executive status, I'll be able to give you a definitive date for that.
Is it possible for counties other than the same counties each time to be included in the P4 project?
Yeah, we'll probably be making. Hi, this is Rick Thompson. Yes, we're currently have an outreach out to about 9 counties, which were the ones that participated in the initial requirements review. And we're soliciting for participation in the upcoming FITGAP and JAD activities. Based on how it's looking right now, we'll probably be putting out a broader email out to the rest of the counties soliciting input and participation as well.
Yeah, but we will be working through the Child Welfare Committee to do such. So we want to work with those the three leads of that group to make sure that we're engaging the counties that feel like they can participate. We know that based on what we've already shared with them, that they don't have enough resources to fill the gap that we'll need.
Somebody said, also wrote in, there are actually over 15 counties involved plus with the original one, so 15 counties. Will equipment funding be provided for services to NCFAS launch?
Yes, that's pertaining to P4.
Can you repeat the question again?
Yeah, will equipment funding be provided for services to the NCFAS launch?
No, we've never provided equipment in the past. I'm not sure if we can get who that is, and maybe they've got some more specifics if they're trying to plan for, or I'm not sure what equipment they're referring to. So I want to make sure that we reach out to them to understand the context of the question.
Thank you. Not equipment. This is the follow-up. Not equipment. Funding to purchase computers. I think that was...
Well, yeah. Hank, I mean...
There's going to be something similar to what was done with the Medicaid reimbursement for purchasing computers to use to determine eligibility. I look at that came from CMS, and I don't know that any of the other versions or sections of ACF would be offering any sort of similar.
Right. That was CMS 75% due at one time. It was in a finite period of time. It was the end of the fiscal year, federal fiscal year. We don't anticipate that there's any federal opportunity on funding at this time.
Okay. Did I hear earlier that vendor payments would not be issued out of NCFAS for LEAP and SIP?
This is David. Yes, that is currently the plan, that for P3, Only the payments to child care providers will be made through direct deposit from the state, but the payments to the vendors for energy assistance will not be.
And I think to the point, just to add to what David is saying there, I think, you know, I think part of that conversation is there's a lot of, particularly in rural areas, you're purchasing wood and things of that nature from vendors would probably create some problems.
If counties want to allocate county funding to child care subsidy, will that be part of P3? Let me read that one more time. If counties want to allocate county funding to child care subsidy, will that be part of P3? Or will the county be encouraged just to issue checks involving its own funding through the county?
So this is David. I can answer that one as well. The way this will work, if the county determines that they would like to use county funds, there will be a role in NCFAST that a county can have. It's called the LPA Fund Manager. They can create basically a county-specific line item where you would allocate a certain amount of funds. When you process the application and identify that you want to pay using those county funds, NCFAST will push that through and indicate on the voucher to the provider that that is where the payment is expected to come from, and then that payment would need to be issued via county check or whatever your process for paying that provider is. It will not be paid through the state at that point.
That was it.
Okay. Hearing no other questions, I think we've come to the end of the conference call. I want to thank everybody for participating. We've gone from having a long call with a lot of different presentations to having a long call with more focused presentations, and but it's all information that's important. A lot of good questions today. I really appreciate the questions that we got in. So thank you all, everybody. I appreciate everybody's hard work, and have a great day.